Hey, what's up guys, Jeremy here. In this video, we will learn how to properly estimate the cycle time of your project. Let's get started. Cycle time is a very important part of any automation project. RoboDK can help you estimate how much time a given task will take with your robot. But before we jump into that, make sure that you have watched the two previous videos, so one on rounding and one on set speed and acceleration. If you didn't watch those, what I'm going to show you now won't be as good or as meaningful, if I can say. So now that we are on the same page, let's look at our station here. So we have the exact same station as we used in the previous two videos. And I just did a few modifications with respect to what we ended up having at the end of the other one. So if you double click the robot, go to parameters here, you will have here, I just went for set speed 100. Acceleration 200, joint speed 200, acceleration 200, and I set the rounding at -1. I'm gonna close that here, perfect. If I run this pick and place program, I can increase the speed here, oops, the simulation speed maybe to 5 to 1 is okay, okay. If I run this program here, till the end, I will see here in the bottom right corner of my screen, you will see the cycle time this path took. So in this case, it was 41.4 seconds. Don't forget that this one, as I have all accurate motion, I have my -1 in my robot parameter window. That means that each motion will have linear acceleration, max speed, linear deceleration. So if I was to do that, this path here would take 41 seconds. If I was to add a set rounding to 1, like I said, doesn't matter which value you use, it's for the cycle time estimation, it's cycle time estimation, it's either -1 accurate or smooth, so which you won't have any slowdown in speed. And then I can run the pick and place application here. And now I'm at 30.9 seconds. So it's important to have your path run completely before you look at that number, because that may change by the end of the program. Especially if you have a change of speed during the program, you really need to look at it completely. A little trick though, so you can run it in fast simulation speed, which is 100 times the simulation speed, and you will end up with the same exact number and the waiting time will be way smaller. So here you see, by just adding the smooth one, we reduced by about 25% our cycle time according to RoboDK. Another thing that you need to be aware of is, I'm gonna bring it back to -1 here. The first, so if I run that here in fast simulation, so now we have 39.9. Here, the first motion from wherever the robot was up to the first point is always calculated in the cycle time. So that might be something you want, or that might be something that you don't want, depending on when, where the robot will start. So if I have the robot like, oops, if I have the robot, I don't know, like here, and I run this program here, oops, now it's hitting a singularity, so that doesn't help. Let's say I'm here, run this here. It's now 43.4 because I added all of that path here for no reason. So what I do generally is I double click the first point to reach that point, then I run the program. So now I know that from here, following all the points, this path here will take 35.8 seconds. So that's something to take into consideration. If you have multiple sub programs to get like bundled together, that's fine. Because you need to calculate the transition time between the points. So transition between the subprograms. So that's important. This is why this is here, and that's taken into account in the cycle time estimation. But if you're just looking at one portion of the path, you might want to reach the first point first. Remember what I said about rounding, where having your having a point where you go in one direction and then in the other direction will inherently cause you to stop and then restart, and that RoboDK doesn't consider that in your cycle time estimation if you have a smoothing of whatever value. So that's something you can kind of handle by yourself if you're just a bit clever and you want to have the best possible cycle time estimation. So what I would generally do, I would have, I'm going to copy that here, edit, make a minus one here. I know that if I reach that point here, this will be an accurate motion. So I will have something like that. Every time I know I will go in one direction and then go in the other one, I will create an accurate before and then a smooth after. And then control C. The next one here is another accurate motion here. Accurate motion here. I will have to add my accurate motion here. Accurate motion here. I will add my smooth afterwards. I'm kind of forcing RoboDK to add that linear acceleration and deceleration. So now I know that I will go from smooth, I'm going to go to first point here, smooth. So I will kind of round that up here without losing any velocity. I will go down here. Then as an accurate, I will stop here. So I will have my complete stoppage acceleration here. And then I will go back to the smoothing and then I will go up. So this way here, I will have this here smoothed out. From this point here, I'm not gonna stop at this point here, not gonna stop at this point here. Then I'm gonna stop here and I'm not gonna stop here, not gonna stop here, gonna stop here. So I'm kind of mimicking the real behavior of the robot in this case here. So if I go to the first point here and then I run that here, now this takes about 30.3 seconds. So that makes sense. Don't forget that, like I said, speed and acceleration will have an impact. So if you here set speed, you can set whatever value you want, let's say 1,000 and here 3,000. This is important for you to go and take a look at your robot documentation. RoboDK is a very flexible software. So we handle robots that goes from a few dozen millimeters per second max at max speed up to robots that can reach multiple meters per second at max speed. And we have no way of knowing what is the limit of your specific robot. It's kind of on you to go within your documentation and make sure that you figure out which is what limit you are facing. One thing that we don't have right now is a way to have a limit of speed on each joint, a variable limit of speed on each joint. So right now we are just applying a given maximum speed equal on each joint, even if we know that some robot may have a relatively big discrepancy between, let's say, the behavior of joint one and the behavior of joint six. So again, it's a bit on you to kind of modify that throughout the program if you want to have the most accurate cycle time estimation as possible. So if you see that one given motion has a lot of motion around joint one, you might want to use the maximum joint speed of joint one for that motion. And then if you see the other one has a lot of motion around joint six, you might want to use this as your limiting speed for one given motion. So you might need to be a bit more granular in the way you set your speed throughout your project. But if your goal is to have the best cycle time estimation possible, that's something you might want to do. We don't consider the dynamic of the robot, so you can't really apply a payload and know how it will impact your robot. This is simply because we support way too many brands and we don't have a way of knowing how the control loop works within the robot controller. It's something that the robot brands kind of keep for themselves as much as possible, which is normal. It's very important IP for them, and they are not really willing to share that with us. So that's again something that we have to keep under our umbrella of estimation. This is why we call that cycle time estimation and not cycle time analysis, because there's still a lot of unknown that we can't really get rid of. But there's a lot of things that we can take care of. Honestly, for this one here, I want to be like, now I went for the kind of the negative part of things, but I did a lot of tests. So I have like, you see, I have a robot behind me, which is the same robot here. And if I was to show you below, you would see that I have, this is the setup I have here behind me. And I have that part with me. And I did some cycle time estimation test with that part here. And if I, when I was following a path like this one for, let's say, gluing, dispensing, debring, stuff like that, I was generally within 1 or 2% the cycle time that RoboDK was giving me. So I would say that this was pretty good. And here for this one, if I made sure to have the accurate at the right spot and have the right acceleration and deceleration and stuff like that, I was within 3 or 4%. So if you do things really, like if you're really granular in the way you add your accurate and smooth motion, in the way you set up your set speed and set acceleration, you should be able to have a pretty good cycle time estimation. Another thing that I need to mention before we leave this or finish this video is that if you add a pause to a program, it will be considered part of the cycle time calculation. So meaning that if you were to add like a 2 second pause here for a certain process to be done, let's say you were dispensing a bunch of glue in the hole for a sealant application, this would be considered part of your cycle time. So it will be like part of the value you have here. Two other things here, if you go to tools and then run script, you have two script here. So cycle time display all, and cycle time study. So cycle time study will tell you, like if you go for, I don't know, pick and place here, it will tell you like if you were to use linear speed and joint speed of, this is a cycle time. So it will kind of give you a general idea of what speed you could have on one end and the other, and what kind of cycle time it would give you. So that might be interesting for you. And the other one here is cycle time display. So if you use this here and you pick, let's say, the pick and place, it will tell you how long it takes to how long this path is and how long it will take to do it. So you have exact same value as here. And this is generally useful if you have a program that uses external axis or has other external mechanism, because if you run a main program that has many mechanism running together, you won't have a cycle time appearing here. It won't show you anything here. It will, yeah, that's kind of one behavior of RoboDK. So if you want to know the cycle time of this type of program, you need to use use the run script and then cycle time display. And then if you go for cycle time display all, it will simply show you the cycle time of each of the programs you have in your station. So that's pretty much everything for this video. I hope it was helpful. In the next video, we will talk about inputs and outputs, another very important topic. So I hope to see you there. In any case, have a great day, guys.